Hi, my name is Nick. Today I'm going to talk about advanced segments in the Google Analytics API. I'll cover what advanced segments can do, how they differ from filters, three ways to reference them in the data feed, and we'll go through simple examples in Java. Say you have an e-commerce website, and many visitors visit your website and purchase products. Using Google Analytics, you can measure for each source of traffic the number of visits, the number of transactions, and the total revenue. Say you want to define a segment of these visits. For example, visits that had greater than $0 in revenue. Let's look at a query to request that from the API. Here is a sample query that can be used to request data from the API. The IDs parameter defines from which profile to retrieve data. The start and end date parameters define the date range to be the entire month of October. The dimensions parameter says to retrieve all sources of traffic. And the metrics parameter says to retrieve the total number of visits, transactions, and revenue for each source of traffic. Now, when we make a request with this query to the API, we get a lot of XML back. That XML can be transformed into a table, which looks like this. There are two important observations about the data returned. First, some rows have $0 in revenue. Second, is that the number of visits and number of transactions for each source are very different. Generally, visitors will make one e-commerce transaction in their visit. And so the reason why the number of visits and number of transactions is different is because this data includes visits that didn't transact and had $0 in revenue. Back to our example, the previous query returned data for all visits to the site, and not the segment of visits that had greater than $0 in revenue. Let's go back to our query and add a filters parameter that defines transaction revenue greater than zero. Let's look at how that affects our results. Notice, now all the sources of traffic have revenue, but the number of visits and number of transactions is still very different, and the data return still includes visits with $0 in revenue. Back in our example, using the filters parameter, all we have done is filter out some sources of traffic, but we still haven't found out the segment of visits that have made a purchase. The Google Analytics API has three new ways to define advanced segments through the API. The dynamic segment is very powerful and allows you to create a new advanced segment directly in the API query. The default segment are the same as the default segments in the Google Analytics web interface and can be referenced by ID. Custom segments can be created using the advanced segment builder in the web interface and also referenced by ID through the API. Let's go through each of these and see how they will work with their original query. In the query, all three types of segments can be defined through a new segment parameter. Next, we add the word dynamic, followed by two colons to signify we wanted to define a new dynamic segment. Next, we add the segment expression, in this case, where transaction revenue is greater than zero. Let's look at what happens to the results. Notice all results have revenue, similar to when we applied a filter. But now, the number of visits is very similar to the number of transactions because all returned visits have greater than $0 in revenue. Something to keep in mind is the number of visits and the number of transactions might not be equal because of revenue attribution and because some visitors might transact multiple times in their visits. Back in our example, by using the segment parameter, we have selected all visits with greater than $0 in revenue, what we set out to do. Because one can define segments directly through the API query, let's look at some examples demonstrating how powerful dynamic segments are. Our original query defined all visits with greater than $0 in revenue. We can easily change that to visits with greater than $1,000 in revenue. The segment parameter supports the same operators as the filters parameter. Here, we've just narrowed the scope of our original segment to only transactions that occurred on Monday. And here, we further narrow the scope to purchases in the United States. We can even change the operator to use a regular expression to say either United States or Canada. But what's really powerful is we can take this segment and apply it to other dimensions, like keyword, or keyword and medium, to differentiate between paid and organic terms. We can even change the metrics to entrances, bounces, and goal completions. The expressive syntax of dynamic segments make them very powerful. Let's now look at how default and custom segments work. Here is a screenshot of the Google Analytics web interface. Notice the section for default and custom segments. Default segments are pre-configured and available for all users. Custom segments are defined for each user and created through the Advanced Segment Builder. Here's a screenshot of the Advanced Segment Builder. Notice we've used the revenue metric to define an advanced segment where revenue is greater than zero, and we've called it visits with revenue greater than zero. Let's now look at how we can reference these segments through the API. Because all account configuration data is in the account feed, each default and custom segment definition is also found in the account feed. Here's an example of the account feed XML. Notice that segments are defined before the entry elements. The new segment elements have an ID attribute. The value of the ID is what is used to reference the segment in the data feed. Notice that all default segments have negative IDs, and all custom segments have IDs greater than or equal to zero. Each segment element also has its name, as well as its definition. The Google Analytics API tries as hard as it can to translate the advanced segments from the web interface to a similar API expression. If, for some reason, the API can't translate the advanced segment, the value is left empty. Now let's see how we can make an API query using these IDs. Here is our example query with the same segment parameter. This time we'll use GAID followed by two colons to specify we want to reference a segment by ID. Finally, we add the ID found in the account feed. Zero, in this example, is the same advanced segment we built earlier in the advanced segment builder that defines all visits with greater than $0 in revenue. Similarly, we can change the ID to -3 to reference a default segment, in this case all returning visits. Now that we've learned how to use advanced segments through the API, let's go through two Java examples. The first will print all the segment definitions in the account feed, and the second will make a query to the data feed and print the results as a table. Here is a simple code example that prints all the advanced segment data in the account feed. This example defines a class called AccountFeedExample with three private members to store the username, the user's password, and the object returned from the API. In the main method, a new AccountFeedExample object is created, then all the goal information is printed. That's the entire program. Let's look at the constructor. In this example, the constructor is responsible for retrieving data from the API. First, a new analytics service object is created with the name of our application. Then the username and password is set using the setUsersCredentials method to specify we want to use the client login authorization routine. Next, a URL object is created to query the account feed. And finally, we use the analytics services class getFeedMember to make a request to the API and return the data in an account feed object. Now we're ready to print the data. The printAdvancedSegments method first checks if the data returned has segments defined. If segments exist, this program gets a list of segments and iterates through each, printing the segment name, ID, and the definition of segments. That's it. This example will print all advanced segments in the account feed. In this example, we make a query to the Google Analytics API using the new segment parameter. Then we print the results as a table. This example defines a class called DataFeedExample. Similar to the AccountFeedExample, it defines a couple of private members to store the username, password, and response from the API. This example also defines a parameter to store the table ID, so the API knows which profile to query. In the main method, a new DataFeedExample object is created, then all entries are printed. And that's it. Let's look at the constructor. The constructor is responsible for retrieving all the data from the API. First, an analytics service object is created, then the user credentials are set. We then create a data feed query object which has helper methods to set the table ID, the date range, the dimension, and metrics. There is also a new setSegment method which we use to create a dynamic segment for all visits with greater than $0 in revenue. Then the program uses the analytics service getFeed method to make a query to the Google Analytics API and return the data in a data feed object. That's how easy it is to get data for a segment of users in Java. Now let's print the results. The printEntriesIsTable method first makes sure there are entries to print. It then iterates through each entry in the feed and for each entry goes to the list of dimensions and prints the dimension name and value. It then goes to the list of metrics and prints the metric's name and value too. And that's it. This simple example will print for the month of October, the sources of traffic, and the number of visits, transactions, and revenue for only visits that generated greater than $0 in revenue. Hopefully, you now understand how advanced segmentation works through the Google Analytics API. For more information, check out our online documentation at code.google.com/APIs/analytics. Also, the complete Java example is available for your reference on Google Project Hosting. Thanks.